Blessed and very pleasant good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Morning Prayer brought to you by the Anglican Diocese of Belize. We are so pleased that you could be with us this morning. Today is the 8th day of June. My goodness, 8 days in June already. It's a beautiful Monday morning here in Dangriga. I pray that your Monday morning is going well as well. We want to start off this morning with an oldie but goodie. We want to start off with the hymn, Morning Has Broken. Let's have a listen.
Morning has broken like the first morning. For the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing, fresh from the world. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven. Like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the left garden, sprung in completeness where we see. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world.
That version of Morning Has Broken brought to us there by, well, performed by Cat Williams. We're going to turn now to our order of service, which will be on screen shortly. And of course, it is the order of service for June 8 in 2020. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." If you are following along in your books of common prayer, we are on page 34. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Our invitatory prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Our first canticle for this morning is the canticle, the Jubilate. If you you are following along in your books of common prayer, we are on page 37. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, it is now, and shall be forever. Amen. At this time, we pause to call to mind those things that in thought, word, or deed we would have done that would have been displeasing to God, that would have been unfair or unjust to our neighbors, or that would have been unfair to our very selves. For these times and these moments, Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Together we pray. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We have several psalms appointed for us this morning, and our psalms are going to be read for us by Miss Jackie Castillo. Let's have a listen.
Have mercy on me, O God, for my enemies are hounding me. All day long they assault and oppress me. They hound me all day long. Truly there are many who fight against me, O Most High. Whenever I am afraid, I will put my trust in you. In God whose word I praise, in God I trust and will not be afraid. For what can flesh do to me? All day long they damage my cause. Their only thought is to do me evil. They band together. They lie in wait. They spy upon my footsteps because they seek my life. Shall they escape despite their wickedness? O God, in your anger, cast down the peoples. You have noted my lamentation. Put my tears into your bottle. Are they not recorded in your book? Whenever I call upon you, my enemies will be put to flight. This I know, for God is on my side. In God the Lord, whose word I praise, in God I trust and will not be afraid. For what can mortals do to me? I am bound by the vow I made to you, O God. I will present to you thank offerings. For you have rescued my soul from death and my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before God in the light of the living.
We continue with Psalm 57. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful, for I have taken refuge in you. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until this time of trouble has gone by. I will call upon the Most High, the God who maintains my cause. He will send from heaven and save me. He will confound those who trample upon me. God will send forth his love and his faithfulness. I lie in the midst of lions that devour the people. Their teeth are spears and arrows, their tongues a sharp sword. They have laid a net for my feet, and I am bowed low. They have dug a pit before me, but have fallen into them themselves. Exalt yourself above the heavens, O God, and your glory over all the earth. My heart is firmly fixed, O God. My heart is fixed, and I will sing and make melody. Wake up, my spirit. Awake, lute and harp. I myself will wake in the dawn. I will confess you among the peoples, O Lord. I will sing praise to you among the nations. For your loving kindness is greater than the heavens, and your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Exalt yourself above the heavens, O God, and your glory over all the earth. Do you indeed decree righteousness, you rulers? Do you not judge the peoples with equity? No, you devise evil in your heart, and your hands deal out violence in the land. The wicked are perverse from the womb, Lives go astray from their birth. They are as venomous as a serpent. They are all like deaf adder, which stops its air, which does not heed the voice of the charmer, no matter how skillful his charming. O God, break their teeth in their mouths. Pull the fangs of the young lion, O Lord. Let them vanish like water that runs off. Let them wither like trodden grass. Let them be like the snail that melts away, like a still-born child that never sees the sun. Before they bear fruit, let them be cut down like a briar. Like thorns and thistles, let them be swept away. The righteous will be glad when they see the vengeance. They will bathe their feet in the blood of the wicked, and they will say, surely there is a reward for the righteous. Surely there is a God who rules in the earth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, it's now, and will be forever. Amen. Our second canticle for this morning is Canticle 9, the first song of Isaiah, based on Isaiah 12, verses 2 to 6. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, it's now, and will be forever. Amen. Our Bible reading for this morning comes from the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 to 14. It is going to be read for us by Miss Tasha Kane. Let's have a listen.
The Old Testament lesson taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 to 14. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for this is the end of everyone, and the living will lay it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of countenance the heart is made glad. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. It is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. For like crackling of thorns under a pot, so is laughter of fools. This also is vanity. Surely oppression makes the wise foolish, and a bribe corrupts the heart. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. The patient in spirit are better than the proud in spirit. Do not be quick to anger, for anger lodges in the bosom of fools. Do not say, why were the former days better than these? For it is not from wisdom that you ask this. Wisdom is as good as an inheritance, an advantage to those who see the sun. For the protection of wisdom is like the protection of money, and the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to the one who possesses it. Consider the work of God, who can make straight what he has made crooked. On the day of prosperity, be joyful. And on the day of adversity, consider God has made the one as well as the other, so that mortals may not find out anything that will come after them. The Word of God.
Thanks be to God. Give me a few minutes here as I shift back to the beginning of the reading. There we have it, from Ecclesiastes 7, verses 1 through to 14. And of course, again, a continuation of the look at the wisdom of Solomon, as it is believed that, again, the book is written by Solomon himself. I am not sure. I think the sun has caught up with my computer. There we go. Ecclesiastes 7. Now, it is interesting because all along we've been hearing Solomon address us from a point of what seems to be despair and from a point of being concerned that nothing in this life is really worth it, but he doesn't know if there is a future after this life, and he's concerned that you live in the here and now. And all of a sudden in Ecclesiastes 7, it seems as if though Solomon is encouraging us to find a better way in life. and it's looking at life through better or worse. So how is it that life is going to be? We don't know if it's going to be good. We don't know if it's going to be bad. But one thing is for certain, we can call upon God. It seems to be the message that Solomon is pushing across. And we begin in verse 1 of chapter 7, where it says, a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. It seems that at the end of chapter 6, Solomon was mournful and discouraged. And this feel goes into verse 1 of chapter 7. It comes from what seems to be a deep and pained sense of the meaninglessness. Is that a word? Meaninglessness. From the meaninglessness that Solomon is suffering under. It's interesting that he uses the fact that a good name is better than precious ointment. Precious ointment, of course, is costly. And if you think about the time of Jesus, where his feet was anointed with costly perfume and wiped with the hair after being bathed in tears, you remember Judas saying to the woman, this money is a lot of wages and could have fed a lot of people. And precious ointment, of course, is still expensive today. I mean, you want a really nice, good smelling perfume, you have to pay the cost for that, no? But a good name is even more precious than that, even more precious than costly perfume. And what allows us a good name? What allows us a good name in the mind of Solomon is that not only that you have wealth or that you have riches, because he would have told us that wealth and riches mean nothing and bring no kind of fulfillment, but that you would have exercised wisdom that would have come from God, that you would have exercised discernment, that you would have kept God on your side and live right for God. And so a good name is better than precious ointment. And then that part seems understandable, but the second half of the first verse, and the day of death better than the day of birth. Why? Why is the day of death better than the day of birth? A lot of people hold on to life. They hold on to the here and now. And all along, Solomon has been telling us, seize the day, live for now, don't let anything hold you back. And all of a sudden, the day of death is better than the day of birth. When you think about it, the day of birth comes with hope for a good life. But there is no guarantee that what you hope for is what is going to pass. The reality is that there is hardships that are going to be faced, and these hardships is ominous. You're gonna get it. But for the believer, the day of death is glorious. Why? It is a day that our battle with the hardships of this life is over. It is a day where our sorrows of this life is over. It is a day where our uncertainties in this life is over, and all things are then made new. But for the believers, not for everybody. And this is what Solomon is going to try to bring across. For those who believe in God, the day of death is better than the day of birth, because the day of birth brings us into a world that is full of turmoil, a world that we would have heard from him last is full of injustice. And so to die and leave the uncertainties, the hardships, and the sorrows of this world behind, and to go to be with your Creator, Solomon is saying, is much better. So the end of a thing is better than the beginning of a thing. And he's going to say this a little bit later. And it says, it is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for this is the end of everyone, and the living relate to heart. And it's interesting that he says that, because, I mean, he seems then to be rejecting his previous hope of finding the meaning of life in pleasure, accomplishment, and wisdom. And now there is only death. And he seems to know that people had a tendency to simply ignore or try to wash away death. And he seems to be telling us that we should not ignore it, but that it's better to squarely confront the reality of death. Not as something we should fear, but as something that brings us hope. And for a fellow that in the beginning seemed to be talking about the only thing that exists is now under the sun, this seems to be now a look at maybe there is a possibility of better after all of this, because all of this seems not to be worth it. You know, he goes on in verse 3 to say, sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of countenance the heart is made glad. And sorrow is better than laughter struck me as really weird. That's not what we feel. We feel that laughter is always better. Yet there are some people that say, unless you're sad, you don't know what it feels like to be happy, or you can't enjoy the fullness of being happy if you have never been sad, because it becomes normal to you. And why would Solomon say that sorrow is better than laughter? Well, he does, because He is determined to sweep away our illusions and wishes about the nature of life. He doesn't want us to see that life is all looking out through rosy-colored glasses. You know, he doesn't want us to forget about his premise of all that exists is now under the sun. He wants us to recognize that difficulties and hardships exist in life. And he goes on in verse 4 to say, the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools in the house of mirth. And that is interesting because no one wants to stay in the house of mourning. I don't know about you, but I don't like a sad countenance all the time. I don't like a depressed state. I mean, it comes, you have hardships, you face difficulties, it weighs down on you. But then what? You don't stay in that place. To stay in that place would be considered depression. And then, well, nowadays you need help. And you hopefully could get help. But nobody wants to stay in that place. And Solomon is saying that the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning and the heart of the fool in the house of mirth. And it's not that he wants you to be happy all the time, and it is not that he wants you to constantly be in a state of euphoria, because then you are not looking at life from the perspective of reality of the hardship that exists. But somehow, even in all of this, he still wants you to look for hope. And that hope comes by those that surround you. And look at verse 5. It says, it is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. Now, Solomon seems to be insisting that a man finds wisdom in adversity and suffering than in ease and comfort. So you gain and you learn from your experience. Well, you're supposed to. You're not supposed to have to go through the same hardship twice, because having gone through the hardship the first time, you're supposed to have gained wisdom. Yes? And it's interesting because to hear the rebuke of the wise, and Solomon is saying, the laughter of fools is nothing but more than a momentary song that has no substance that it leaves behind. So there is no praise from the praise of fool, but the advice of the wise makes an impact upon the life of he who is willing to listen to the advice. You know, it's better to be cautioned and guided by someone that is wise than for someone who doesn't have your best interests at heart, than for someone who is simply saying things to make you feel good about yourself, to praise you and lift you up when that is not the case. Yes? And he goes on to say, for like the crackling of thorns under a pot, so the laughter of fools is vanity. Surely oppression makes the wise foolish. And he's just talking there about the fact that he seems to be praising the role of adversity, and it's difficult to understand because he wants the hardships, because he wants us to understand that suffering has its limits. It could destroy a wise man's reasoning, but it doesn't last always. And he seems to be encouraging us to persevere through all of it. And verse 8 says, it's better the end of a thing than the beginning. The patient in spirit are better than the proud in spirit. The better for the end of a thing than the beginning. And you would think, better for the end of a thing? Well, consider it. Consider it. Yes? If it is a success that is in the end is better than the hardships that you would have faced working towards a success. And if the thing is a negative, harmful, painful thing, the end of that is still better than the beginning, because it means you would have triumphed and persevered through the difficulties. And I like this verse. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning, because it talks about having overcome. And there are so many people who are going through too many difficulties in life. And even if it is such that people are experiencing joy at the moment, joy normally comes after a period of some type of hardship. After overcoming, then comes the joy, then comes the reward. And that is what Solomon is trying to bring across. And he's saying the end of the thing is better than the beginning. So be patient in spirit rather than be proud in spirit. Hold on till the end. Do not be quick to anger, for anger lodges in the bosom of a fool, he said. And this is Don't be overwhelmed by the hardship and become anger, because out of this anger, you can then create further hardship for yourself, he seems to be saying. And if you hold on to the anger, all you do is you hurt yourself. You do not necessarily hurt that which you are angry or he who you are angry with. And so to hold on to this anger is to be holding on to it foolishly. And he says, do not say, why were the former days better than these days? And here it is interesting, because Solomon seems to understand a tendency that exists of romanticizing the past and thinking that it is better than the current time. And this is something that still exists. You know, such and such used to do this. You remember when we used to this? Men, back in the days, you these things sound familiar to you? Because we tend to romanticize the past. And what Solomon is cautioning against is you need to know that the meaningless, it makes no sense. It is pointless. It is meaningless to think about the things that have gone by, because you can't necessarily get them back. And this is all a part of his live for the now under the sun premise. And he's not saying you should not be concerned. And we will hear Marcus Garvey in our own time say, a man without a knowledge of his past is like a tree without roots. Because the past is important for us to learn lessons from. And Solomon is saying that learn from your hardship, learn from your experience, but do not stay in that place. Yes, do not stay in that place. Do not say that those days were better than these. Do not try to compare where you are to where you have been. Yes, for it is not wisdom that you should ask this, says Solomon. Wisdom is as good as an inheritance and an advantage to those who see the sun. And he goes back to his theme of wealth is not all important, but knowledge is important. And you know that knowledge is important to Solomon, because that is what he asks God for. That is what he asked God for, wisdom. He didn't ask God for wealth, and all these other things were added to him because he sought the wisdom of God. And he goes on to say in verse 12, for the protection of wisdom is like the protection of money, and the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to the one who possesses it. And it is interesting, because wisdom then has more value than material possessions, and it deserves to be guarded and protected, is what Solomon is saying. And the advantage of knowledge over money is that knowledge gives life to those who have it. Money might give enjoyment momentarily, but what happens when the money fades away or the money disappears? But when you are wise, no matter your financial status, no matter your material possessions, your wisdom still guides you along a right path in life. Your wisdom still brings you that which you need, that which you will have to abide by. And he goes on to say, you know, consider the work of God, who can make straight what he has made crooked. And that's it. Who can make straight that which God has made crooked? Better than that, who can make crooked, if you want to turn it around, that which God can make straight? In other words, God has the final say. He has the final say. And to live for anything other than him is pointless. On the day of prosperity, be joyful, and on the day of adversity, consider this. God has made the one as well as the other, so that mortals may not find out anything that will come after them. And that's the point that Solomon is trying to make. And that's the message we need to walk away with. Yes, that's the message we need to walk away with. That whether it is good or whether it is bad, God has done it. And we have to trust in him. And when we go back to the line of it is the ending is for thing is better than it, better than the beginning, we think of the fact that God is Alpha and Omega. We think of the fact that he knows the end from the beginning. And verse 14 sums it up. On the day of prosperity, be joyful, and on the day of adversity, consider this. God has made the one as well as the other. I don't know who's facing what today. I don't know what it is you're going through, because I don't know your personal circumstances. But this is a message that you can walk away with. In the adversity, God is there. In the prosperity, God is there. In the indifference in between, God is there. And therefore, if God is there in all things, we can't change the past, we can't predict the future. And even the uncertainties and the hardships of now is difficult for our human minds to comprehend. But God knows all things. Why not then, instead of worrying about the condition of what is or what will be, concern ourselves with being connected to God? He knows all things. All things are in His hands. Walk with Him. And this was the message that Solomon was trying to tell us. God is in control of all things. We can't change the past. We don't know what will be ahead, but God does. So hold on to Him. Through his riches, through his wealth, through his concerns, through his days of darkness, Solomon, in his wisdom, held on to that which was most valuable. He held on to God. And that is our motivation. In all things, stay close to God. Amen. We continue then by professing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. As our Savior has taught us, so let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Using suffrage B, if you are following along in your books of common prayer, we are on page 44. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon the earth and your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. Our collect for this morning is the collect for Proper 5, which can be found on page 174. Let us pray. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant that by your inspiration we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guide may do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. A prayer for the poor and the neglected. Almighty and most merciful God, we remember before you all poor and neglected persons whom it would be easy for us to forget, the homeless and the destitute, the old and the sick, and all who have none to care for them. Help us to heal those who are broken in body or spirit, and to turn their sorrow into joy. Grant this, Father, for the love of your Son, who for our sake became poor, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A prayer of self-dedication. Almighty and eternal God, so draw our hearts to you, so guide our minds, so fill our imaginations, so control our wills, that we may be wholly yours, utterly dedicated unto you. And then use us, we pray you, as you will, and always to your glory and the welfare of your people. Through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we want to offer prayers of thanksgiving for all persons who are celebrating birthdays or would have celebrated a birthday over this weekend. We remember Miss Simone Isigeri and Miss Sophia Burgess. We remember as well Miss Agnes Stevens, who celebrated a birthday. And today I want to say a happy birthday to my friend Mr. Davidson Bowen, who is in Barbados and celebrating his birthday today. Father Bowen, we pray that God continues to bless you with this new year of life. We continue to offer God thanksgiving for those who are recovering from surgery and illness. We remember Miss Judith, Mr. Rudolph, and Mr. Normando Rabateau. We continue to pray for healing for Miss Monica, Miss Margaret, Miss Ines, Miss Norma, Miss Eileen, Miss Sylvia, Miss Harris, Miss Haley, Miss Pauline, for Miss Des, Miss Harmony, Miss Claudia, Miss Rose, and Miss Jane. We pray as well for Mr. Larry, Mr. Zelaya, Mr. Finley, Mr. Rupert, Aaron, Jordan, Emery, Norman Usher, Mr. Linford Hope, and for Mr. Kenneth. Praying that God will extend his hands of healing upon you and grant you ease from your discomfort. We continue to pray as well for all those who care for those who are infirmed, remembering Miss Marva and Miss Sonia at this time. We continue to pray for those who are infected by COVID-19. We remember our one patient that we have here in Belize. We pray for those in our region and across the world who are still infected, and we pray that as a society we continue to do what is necessary in order to slow the spread of this infection. We pray as well for a cure or a vaccine for this disease. We continue to pray for families who are in mourning of those who have died. We pray that God will grant them comfort and peace during this time of bereavement, and that he will grant eternal rest to those who have passed away. We pray for the continued protection of our loved ones who are far away from us. We continue to remember our students, Miss Tammy, Mr. Anwar, Miss Karina, Miss Courtney, and Miss Keisha. We pray that God will continue to sustain you at this time. We continue to pray for wayfarers at sea, for persons who are still stuck in cruise ship quarantine, for military persons overseas, for Emil and Jade. We continue to pray for persons who are stuck in countries other than their own, praying for specifically Miss Maureen at this time. We continue to pray for our brother, Mr. Michael Sammons. We remember our nurses and doctors who are selflessly giving of themselves, and we pray for the enablement and protection of all medical professionals in the performance of their duties. Remembering Dr. Molina, Nurse Gill, Nurse Marilee, Nurse Alejandra, Nurse Aaron, and all others at this time. We continue to pray as well for the combating of the economic fallout caused by this COVID-19 pandemic. We pray for industries that would have been affected, praying especially for those in the tourism and service industry, those in the aviation and transport industry. We continue to pray for the most vulnerable in our society, praying for the poor, the needy, the elderly, those with pre-existing conditions, those whose living circumstances do not afford them the opportunity to isolate or to quarantine. We pray for our security forces, for the government, the churches, the private sector, and all non-governmental organizations who are involved in the fight against COVID-19. We give God thanks for all their efforts in keeping us safe, in keeping us focused, in keeping us bonded together in fellowship. We continue to pray for members of the national and international community who in any way, shape, or form presently suffer as a result of COVID-19. For the prayers of our hearts that our tongues cannot confess, we ask that Almighty God would hear our prayers. We conclude our intercessions by praying together. Almighty and eternal God, sanctify and govern our hearts and bodies in the ways of your law and the works of your commandments, that under your protection now and ever we may be preserved in body and soul through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By way of announcement, brothers and sisters, I want to thank you for joining me for morning prayer this morning. It is indeed a privilege to be able to fellowship with you at this time. We thank you for joining us for our service yesterday. We want to thank the Bishop, Mrs. Wright, and all persons who worked to make our service yesterday a beautiful one. The singing and the music was so lovely. The message from the Bishop was very timely and on point. And we just give God thanks for all who worked in order to make sure that we had a wonderful fellowship yesterday. We thank you for joining us for our other services during the day yesterday as well. And we look forward to you joining us for today. Remember that we have noonday devotions, we have children's Bible minutes at 2:30, we have evening prayer at 4, and compline at 9 p.m. tonight. We look forward to joining you for these worship sessions, and we pray that they continue to be a blessing upon you in as much as they are a blessing to us as we lead them. I believe there are a couple of churches that are opening up this Sunday. Once they have followed the protocols and guidelines set in place, please be on the lookout for notices as to which churches are going to be reopening this weekend. We want to thank you for your patience. We want to thank you for your support. And we pray God's continual blessing upon you. We conclude our service with the prayer of dedication, the grace, and our closing song. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and to serve our persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. We close this morning with a portion of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy. This one, of course, is Joyful, Joyful. I do pray you have a blessed and wonderful day. Until next time, bye for now.